are asked to do any kind of public speaking. If you're nervous at all, I've found that it's helpful to bring friends. And so these are a couple of my friends. I'd ask that you don't stare at them the whole time because they already are a little bit self-conscious about having to live in a fishbowl. And so, you know, please don't stress them out. So I want to start this morning with a good biblical question. Most preachers should do that, I think. How many of you have heard in the Bible of the Great Commission? Okay, so about 10% of the church. Awesome. Okay, let's start over. I know it's later in the day. First service struggled with this a little bit, so we'll give you an easier start. How many of you have heard of the Huskers? Okay, so 90% of the church have heard of the Huskers, 10% have heard of the Great Commission. New sermon series, GBR, not Go Big Red, it's God, the Bible, redemption, okay? You need to be here. 10% of you can take off for a month, right? No. Who would be willing, I know we're not supposed to shout in church, but it is okay, who'd be willing to just shout out, like, you don't have to quote the Great Commission, but what is the point? Like, what is the Great Commission? Make disciples, thank you. And in order to do that, we've got to see people get saved, and then we've got to see them spend time with the Savior so that He can mature and grow them to become more like Him. Isn't it amazing how simple it is? Now, I brought with me some fish today. And the question I have is, what would happen if we took them out of the fishbowl and we just put them down here in the sanctuary on the floor? Yeah, I think they're probably going to die, right? But you can't trust my word for that. I actually want to find out what will really happen if I take them out of the water and I throw them on the ground. They're probably going to die, but let's kind of find out. Is everyone ready? There's a couple people not ready for this. Boy, you're pretty. Right there, you're mine. Thanks for volunteering. That is being voluntold right there. So we have... Oh, doesn't seem to like it. Now, right now, the fish is dying. In order for the fish to live, you'd have to pick it up and put it in the water. So here's my question. Why are you watching it die? Why are you watching it die? All you have to do is pick it up and put it in the water. Is anyone willing to do that? Okay. They're coming now. Still alive. Oh, I just... Yeah, like that. There you go. It's not as easy as it looks. Awesome. Totally fine. But wouldn't have been. Now, let me ask, what's your name? Say it again. Bonnie. Did Bonnie save the fish? Yes. Seems like it, right? The water saved the fish. What Bonnie did was to be willing to get down low and pick it up and introduce it to the water. You know, every time we meet Andrew in the Bible, he's introducing someone to Jesus. We put a lot of pressure on ourselves when it comes to the Great Commission because we think we got to save people. Let me tell you something. There is a Savior. You are not Him. I am not Him. Our job is just simply to introduce people to Jesus. And once you get introduced to Jesus, it becomes really critical that you do life with Jesus. You see, there's a lot of us, we don't really want to do life with Jesus, we just want salvation. Because we view the Christian life as living in a fishbowl. Now that I'm a Christian, everyone's going to judge everything I do, and I'm living in a fishbowl. Yep. That's the truth. And so what we do is kind of like the prodigal son. We say there's a whole world out there. Now let me ask you, there is a whole world out there. Where would it be better for the fish to do life, out there or in here? Where would it be better for you to do life? In here? Through the power of God's word? Or in your own strength? You see, the prodigal son thought, you know, if I just get all the cash, if I get all the resources from God, then I can go out there and live my life however I want because I have God's resources. Big difference between his resources and him. You can have all the stuff, but that's not what's going to make life go well. It's the Savior, not the stuff. And what happens? He ends up in the pig pen. Can I ask you a question? Do you want to live life in the fishbowl or in the pig pen? See, you and I have convinced ourselves that life's going to be so much better if I do it the way I want to do it. But the prodigal son came to, the Bible says, came to his senses in regards to his condition, but not necessarily his position. See, he realized it's no fun living in the pig pen, but he came up with a plan to try to get back into God's love. I will no longer be a son. I'm not worthy. And some of you feel that today. And so I will come up with my own way of being able to get back into God's graces and God's love. And what I love about the story is when the son's like, well, I'm no longer worthy to be a son, the father doesn't even entertain it. He doesn't argue it. It's not an arguable point. If you have given your life to Jesus Christ, you are a son or daughter of the King, and nothing can change that, including what you do with your life. And so the father puts a ring on, he puts the robe on, he puts the sandals, and he says, let's go feast. Now, how many of you have heard, and we'll start with men first, and the context of marriage. And guys always ask me, why are you picking on me? You're called to be the leader. So it's time to lead. So we always go to the leader first. How many of you men have heard in the Bible, Ephesians 5:25, that you are to love your wife the way Christ loves the church? Any men heard? Yeah, man. Haven't heard the Great Commission, but I have heard that I'm supposed to love my wife. No, I'm kidding. I'm giving you a hard time. How many of you wives have heard that you're supposed to respect your husband? Okay. Maybe not as many wives are willing to admit they've read that passage. That's okay. How many kids have heard that you're to obey your parents? Yeah? So why don't we do what God's called us to do? Because it's hard. Because the truth is, we'd rather focus on ourselves. Because for many of us, we have not grown up. We've been introduced to Jesus, but we're really not truly doing life with Jesus and letting him reveal those areas where we need to mature. Now, I'm going to answer for the guys. You can thank me later for taking one for the team. Here's the question. Is it easy to love your wife the way Christ loves the church? Now, guys, you don't have to answer that. You're not going to get in trouble today. I'll answer it. No way. That's tough. That's really hard. You know why? It's not because my wife's hard to love. It's because I'm selfish. And I want to love me first. Ladies, how hard is it for you to respect your husband, especially when he's being a jerk? The reason Angel's at the coffee bar is she said amen on this, okay? And I kicked her out. You got to amen at the right times. Come on, honey. No, I'm kidding. But it's hard, right? How hard is it? Remember when you were a kid or you're a kid right now? It is hard to obey your parents. And when they say you got to go to bed at 8 and you can't have sugar and pizza for supper, and you're like, man, but I want to stay up till at least 9 and I want to eat whatever I want. And your parents said, no, that's not what you're going to do. Okay, I'm going to obey you. It's hard, right? Paul talks about this in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. And I'd like you to turn there with me to verse 11. 1 Corinthians 13:11. Now, this is the famous love passage. We just had a wedding here yesterday. This is what gets read at a lot of weddings. But we stop short of this verse. We talk about what love isn't and what love is, and we focus on that. And what Paul is saying is, Love is the most excellent way. And because of that, because of how love changes us, the love of Jesus Christ, here's how we should respond. Verse 11, when I was a child, I spoke and thought and reasoned as a child, but when I grew up, I put away childish things. Most of us have never connected that that comes right after the love chapter. If love is the most excellent way, and we're going to walk in the love of God, we're going to do life with God, then we have to grow up. And every one of us in this room right now, we all have one thing in common, at least one thing. We all have childish behavior. Let me give you some examples of childish behavior. It's never happened in the history of Broken Bow Berean, but occasionally outside of this church, there are moms who have this issue. Have a wonderful dinner together, she's cooked, we all sit down and eat, and then dad and the kids get up and they go off to the living room and they're going to play a game and mom's left to do all the cleaning up, right? And she's a little frustrated about that. But rather than be an adult, she lets the child out. See, the adult would say, family, would you be willing to come and help? Invite them in to help. If we could clean this up, put everything away, I could join you and we could have a great family night together. But instead of doing that, the child in her starts to bang the dishes a little louder than you normally would as we put them into the sink. Wait, maybe there are one or two women in the Berean Fellowship that have done this. But not in Broken Bow. Just the Berean Fellowship. She's banging the cupboards, the pots and pans. It's called passive-aggressive behavior. Why do we do that? You see, if your family join you and come help because they're like, mom's mad. Mama ain't happy, ain't none of us going to be happy. We better rush to the kitchen, fix this. They're joining you out of guilt, out of shame. You don't want people to join you in serving out of guilt and shame. It's the worst way to get you to be involved in serving. Why wouldn't we invite them? Because we fall into this childish behavior. Here's another one. If you really want to ruin your marriage, free advice. Silent treatment. I've watched two grown adults not talk for 4 days. Well, that's really mature. Or the husband might say to his wife, well, honey, what's wrong? Or she says to the husband, what's wrong? And he says, well, if you don't know, I'm not telling you. Like, how is that going to help the marriage? Okay, so now we need the gift of telepathy to be able to do marriage. It's not in the Bible, people. God knows all things, but you have to communicate if you want your spouse to know all things. Here's one of my favorites. It's called tattling. Kids do this all the time, right? The grown-up version is gossip. And we know that's a sin in the Bible. So we still want to participate in childish behavior, but we know it's not right, so we spiritualize it. Pastor Tice, I don't know if you know about Angel. I don't know if she can hear out there or not, but we'll find out later. But anyway, she's really struggling with, and we need to pray for her. It's tattling. That's gossip. But see, we spiritualized it, kind of like the Pharisees do. Do you know, are you aware of your childish behavior? You see, we need to sit before the Lord and be quiet. Silence and solitude. I think three of the most ignored spiritual principles today that are to connect us to the heart of God are fasting, silence, and solitude. For you and I to actually go before God and say, show me my childish behavior. Why? Because it's affecting. Why would we talk about this? Not just because it's in the Bible, but I believe it is doing more damage to marriages and more damage to the church than about anything else. I've watched grown adults say, well, if that's the way it's going to be and I don't get my way in this church, I'm going to take my toys, I'm going to quit tithing, I'm going to leave. Because I'm not willing to grow up and deal with my childishness. David sat before the Lord and he said, Lord, search my heart and show me if there's any anxious way. Why anxious? Well, that's fear. The opposite of that is faith. God, show me where I'm really not trusting you. That's a great question. And you know, God loves you enough, he'll show that. But then he said this, show me if there's any anxious way, and show me anything that offends you. We are so quick today to get offended. We're offended by everything today because we make it all about our feelings, but what if we made it about the Father? I'm not saying you can't feel, but it has to be filtered through your faith, through God's Word. You know, here's the reality. We looked at this scripture that says, when I was a child, I talked like a child. That is your behavior. And this is, I thought like a child. That's your belief system. I reasoned. That's the connection between the two. Your beliefs will drive your behavior. And there are many of us today, we are just so upset with the behavior of the world, with the gender issues and the protesting issues and the political issues. And what we want is people just to behave. It's never going to happen until their behavior change or their belief changes. The reason the fish is flopping on the floor is it needs the water. It's not trying to be annoying, but it's messing up the carpet and it's kind of annoying to you and I. And what we're saying is just behave. We would be more comfortable if it would just die. Can I ask you a question? Why did most of us just sit and watch? Because most of us were in shock. Can't believe he did that. Some of us were like, well, I don't want to go up front. I mean, is this a joke? Or I mean, like, I might get uncomfortable. I might look like an idiot. I mean, I'm going to have to kneel or bend down to pick the fish up. And I don't want to humble myself. Pride. There's a lot of reasons why we didn't rush the stage to see the fish get saved. And there's also a lot of reasons why we're not rushing our community to see people get saved. What if they look at me and they think I'm an idiot? But see, we're focused on ourselves, we're focused on our feelings instead of what God's calling us to do. And so the reality is David sits with the Lord and he says, show me, where am I offending you? What if we were more concerned with offending the Father than with being offended? How would that radically change us? You see, there's a reason we're seeing all this craziness in our culture. They need Jesus. There's a hole in their heart. They're sucking on air, flopping around like fish. And if we want to change the behavior of our culture, we've got to change the belief, and the same is true in our lives. But it takes you sitting quietly before the Lord. Silence and solitude. We don't spend very much time there, do we? Because it's uncomfortable. Do you know how bad it has gotten in the church when it comes to silence and solitude? Do you know what we actually use silence and solitude for? To punish our children. It was intended to connect us to the heart of God. It was intended to connect us in relationship. And what do? Go stand in the corner. Go to your room. We cut off relationship instead of connecting relationship. Is it any wonder that we have a whole generation today that doesn't want to have anything to do with silence and solitude because you view it as punishment? It was never intended to punish you. It was intended to connect you to the heart of God so you could experience His love, His grace, and His mercy, and expose the childish behavior in your life so that you could grow up and become the man or woman of God that He intended for you to be. Let me ask you this question. Silence and solitude for punishment's purpose. I don't want to offend anybody, but can I ask this question? How well has the timeout generation really worked? It hasn't worked. Why? Because that's not the vehicle that God wants to use to correct people. It's not punishment. It's to search our hearts and to be before the Lord. And so Paul says here, when I became a man, I put away, the Greek word there is katargio. It means to render inoperable to cut out like a cancer. You can't leave a little bit of the child in there. We cannot be men children or women. I can't be a man child and sometimes let the child out. If you're not willing to sit with God, can I suggest something? If you have teenagers, ask them what your childish behavior is, mom and dad. I'd rather sit with the Lord, tell you the truth. Ask a close friend, what's childish behavior you see in my life? Where do I need to grow up? And where does this come from? Well, you and I need to understand that there are a lot of influential people in our lives, teachers, we have coaches, we have parents, pastors, and sometimes they say things that damage our belief system, like, why you got to be so quiet? Why can't you go out and play like the other kids? Well, as a child, you're not able to say, I'm an introvert. You know, maybe it's, why can't you be more like your brother or sister? What does that mean? Like the fact that they get good grades or they're good at sports, or like, how am I supposed to be like them? One of the worst things you can say to someone is, be more like another human being. Be more like Jesus, not your sibling. And we say these things and they can be very damaging. But sometimes parents say things that are good things and we interpret it wrong. This happened to my wife. She grew up in a great family, farming, ranching in Nebraska. And her parents would give her a list of chores to do. It's good for kids to have chores to do and work. And they would come and they would check the list. But Angel noticed that if she got everything done and done right, she got praise. But if she didn't, she got in trouble. And the way that she interpreted that message was, if I get the list done, I'm loved and worth something. And if I don't, I'm not worthy of being loved and I have no worth. It's not what her parents said. They were trying to help her to grow up to be responsible. But she interpreted it wrong. And it's amazing how many of us have heard messages that were damaging or we've interpreted it to be damaging. So let's fast forward a few years until she meets Prince Charming, which is me. Marriage is, you know, love is blind, but marriage is the alarm clock that will wake you up, if you haven't figured that out. Some of you are like, yeah, it's still ringing. And so I don't really know why we did this, no planning on our part, but we had three kids. They were born in 97, 98, and 99. Y2K was coming. Look it up in the history books. I mean, it was a long time ago, but, you know, it was coming. And so we had these three kids in diapers, and I would come home as bivocational pastor. I was roofing houses, building houses, and pastoring a church. And I would come home. I was so excited to see my family. And I'd walk in the door, and I'd see Angel, and I would ask this question, what did you do today? Sounds a lot like the list, right? But I had no idea about her belief system and her past. And she'd really react negatively to that. She just shut down. And I was like, man, I really wanted to connect with her heart. I asked how her day was going. I didn't, by the way. I said, what'd you do, right? So then, because my love language is acts of service, I start looking around at all the things that are undone. And I start picking up, start doing dishes. Well, think about this. I walked in, said, what did you do? And then I point out all the things that she didn't do. Right? I was walking in, lighting a match, throwing gas on it. And she was just not a fun lady to be around. And I couldn't figure out what was going on. And so one day I said something to my wife that no man should ever say to a woman. I said this out loud. I feel like you are an unlovable woman. Every woman in the room just went, and every man said, I don't know you, you're dead to me. It's okay, disown me. It'll be worth it. But see, that's how I felt. Because I had no idea I was triggering a false belief system. That you're only worth something if you get things done. You're only worthy of love if you get things done. And so I said to her, I'm like, honey, the reason I think you're unlovable is I come home, I ask how your day went, and she interrupted me and she said, you didn't ask how my day went. You said, what did you get done? And then you point out everything I don't get done, and you make me feel worthless. Wow. Like, I'm sorry. And then I asked probably the greatest question that we can ever ask another human being. What do you need? I knew what I needed. I needed a wife that wasn't so hostile when I would come home. Right? But what I didn't understand is she was fine before I got home. It was when I started to make her feel unloved and unworthy that she reacted this way. And when I said, what do you need? She said, I just need you to sit with me. It's been 14 hours with people that can't talk. I need an adult conversation. Now, the mess bothered me. Be honest. So I just turned my chair so I couldn't see the mess, and all I could see was my wife. And some of us, what we're doing in our marriages is we're positioning ourselves to focus on the problems, not the person. And we talked. And it radically changed our relationship. But you see, Angel had to deal with that childish belief system so that she wouldn't act childish. Here's the reality. The only way to change your belief system is to get in the Bible. Is to go back and say, what does God say? And what was radical for us is as we started to identify, and here's some things that you need to do. You need to identify, where does this belief system come from? You need to identify that it is a lie. And then you've got to find the truth. What does God say? God says this, even while you were still a sinner, Christ died for you. When you were at your worst, and maybe you deserved to be rejected, God didn't do that. He still chose you. Ephesians chapter 1, says, before the foundation of the world, God's plan was to adopt you, and this gave him great pleasure. That I am loved, a part of my performance. And some of us, we've fallen into the list. We have fallen into performance-based living. Some of us, it's because of fear. And so we are performing so that we don't ever have to fail. I can't afford to fail. For some of us, I can't afford to be rejected. And so it's performance-based living. You guys in town had a track meet yesterday. You know, two of the most fascinating events at the track meet for me are high jump and pole vault. You know why? Even the winner loses. It's the only event. Like in the 100, the guy that wins the 100 doesn't say, I'm going to go back and try to beat my time. Yep, I lost. I'm a loser. But we keep setting the bar, right? We keep moving the bar until eventually we fail. That's performance-based living. Some of you are saying things to yourself like, I can't believe I'm so dumb. How come I didn't get that right? What is wrong with me? You are replaying the messages that you heard as a kid, as a teen, as a young adult. That's your belief system, and it is driving your behavior. And so we got to go back and say, what does God say? Where did it come from? Identify it as a lie. And then you start to look at what is the truth. I have with me here a bottle of water. By the way, hang on. I'm getting a little thirsty. You didn't think about that, did you? All right, we're good now. Imagine this is you. Really start allowing the truth to go from your head to your heart. Because it says this in Romans 12, 1 and 2. No longer be conformed to the pattern or the thinking of this world, those false belief systems. Instead, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. It doesn't say be transformed by the filling of your mind. And there are many of us, we are just going to Bible studies and just filling our minds, but it's not coming down, it's just information instead of transformation. People ask me all the time, well, how much scripture should I study? Whatever you're willing to be obedient to. That's my standard answer. Because seriously, what is the point of studying something you're not going to live? That's what the Pharisees did. Didn't change their lives, it's just a bunch of hypocrites, right? And so you and I have to start to fill our lives with the water of God's Word. We have to do life with God. We have to say, you know, I'm not going to live in the pig pen with the false belief system. I'm going to live in the fishbowl with the truth. I'd also suggest you pick some backup verses. Why? Well, a running back does better when he's got some blockers out front. If you want to start scoring some touchdowns in your life, in your marriage, in your parenting, those kinds of things, and seeing God at work, get the Word of God out in front of you. You know, it's amazing, Deuteronomy, Moses was told, you know, bind it, put it on your doorposts, bind it as, you know, on your eyes. Put it before you, the actual Word of God, and believe that truth. So I would encourage you, take those verses that speak truth into the lies, the false belief systems that you have, and what you do with those verses, post them in prominent places. Put it on your mirror. Hopefully you look in the mirror before you go out in the morning. Maybe not. I don't know. I'd suggest it. Your hair might be a little weird. Okay? Go ahead and put it on your fridge. Put it in your car. Put it on your phone. Use technology for you, not against you. Program it into your phone. You are the beloved child of the Most High God. Let it pop up at random times of the day where you're like, oh man, I needed that reminder right now. I'm starting to believe lies about myself. Let me ask you this question. Where are you living life? Is it really in here? Because if the only time that you're really in here is when Pastor Tice is preaching, then realistically what you're doing is you're saying, man, I'm going to come try to gorge on Sunday and get through to the next Sunday. It's not going to work. You got to be in the Word, but more importantly, the Word has to be in you. Transformation, not just information. Are you really living in here? And then let me ask you this question. Who are you inviting to join you? I don't mean this in a guilt way. I'm just asking questions that I think Jesus would ask. Who have you talked to about Jesus this week? Who do you know that's a fish flopping on the floor? Maybe it's your annoying neighbor that you're like, I just wish he'd get his act together or move. Because you know what? I care more about me not being annoyed than I do about him going to hell. I've been there, even as a pastor. Where I just want their behavior to change. I don't really want their belief to change. And guess what? There's some people that are living really good lives that are going to hell. They're not annoying anybody. They're doing all kinds of good things, but they've never, ever really been introduced to Jesus. And so they might not be annoying, but they're going to hell. Who have you shared Jesus with in the last month? What about in 2020? Incredible opportunity. Everyone's in a panic. But we have the truth, right? Can I tell you my favorite part of the Bible? It's the last part. It says this, we win. Okay? Doesn't say the Republicans or the Democrats win. It doesn't say that, you know, the culture wins. We win. Whether I live or die, I win. And you and I need to take that winning mentality today and share with other people. Hey, do you want to be on the winning team? Let me pray. But I want you to think about that. Where are you doing life? And who are you inviting to join you? Father, thanks for today. Thank you for speaking into our hearts. Help us in this area of needing to grow up and mature. Help us to change our false belief systems with truth. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
We're going to transition to a time of communion. And communion is an opportunity to remember. It's an opportunity to remember.